you might not follow the remaining slides. Okay, so feel free to interrupt me whenever you feel like. Okay, and so we'll keep this lecture informal in the sense that it's not one way traffic. So wherever you feel like, you can interrupt me and ask question. Okay, so how many of you have heard of some eukaryotic system or eukaryotic models of protein expression? I guess most of you must have heard. I want one or two answers. Any system you know for eukaryotic system for protein expression? Anybody can tell, one or two person. Yeast, yes. Yeast system, zebrafish. Anything else you know? Okay, anyway, so we will be discussing more systems, but yeah, Drosophila. Okay, so yeah. So these are eukaryotic systems, but not essentially all system. Eukaryotic systems are good for protein expression. Okay, you know, yeah, I'm seeing more systems, but you know, some of these systems are really good for transient gene expression and their downstream pathway analysis. Okay, but when it comes to protein expression and purification, one of the prime goal is to be able to make enough or sufficient amount of protein. You want that your protein express, like as Dr. Gopalji must have told you in the prokaryotic system, E. coli system, that we get a ton of protein. Like if you use the select, you select the correct host, select correct vectors, then you can overexpress your protein of interest, recombinant protein. Almost it can go up to 20 to 30% of total E. coli proteins. Okay, so the eukaryotic system, although they don't produce that much protein, but still, like, you want to find a system where significantly amount of protein is produced. Okay, so there are this all the model systems which I saw listed by students, they are all eukaryotic systems, but they are not model system for protein expression. Okay, because you want a lot more protein to express and purify. Okay, so today we'll discuss some eukaryotic models. Okay, and what are their advantages and disadvantages, and let's see if there are any questions. We can raise the questions in between and answer them. Okay, so I will share my slides now and then we'll start.
So you should go to people and search Ravi Vijayvargiya and his presentation. There are two Ravi Vijayvargiya presentation, and click there, means pin it, then you will see his presentation.
Yes. Are you able to see my slides now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So yeah, we'll start with as I told before that we will start with introducing some eukaryotic systems. I'll give you brief overview of some systems, and then eventually we'll go into more details about insect cell baculovirus system. Okay, so let's start with the overview first. Okay, so these are the, some of the commonly used prokaryotic expression systems which some of you already know about, like E. coli or Escherichia coli, Lactobacillus lactis, and other bacillus species are also used as a prokaryotic system. Then another system which we'll be discussing today in detail is insect cells. Insect cells, they are infected with baculoviruses to generate stable cell lines, and they can be used for expression of proteins. Thirdly, we can also have in vitro expression system, in which we don't need live cells. Okay, what we need is the live, not live cell, but the machinery, cell machinery, and in vitro also we can use that machinery to express our protein of interest. So for example, one of the common system for in vitro expression is rabbit reticulocyte lysate. So the RBC lysate, the lysate of that have all the machinery required for protein expression, so that lysate can be used. Wheat germ extract also, that also can be used for in vitro expression, and E. coli extract. Okay, so these are all in vitro system in which we don't express the protein inside the cell, but we take out the entire machinery, lyse the cell, and the entire machinery is in a append of tube or a test tube. There we put our vector of interest, and we can get our protein of interest expressed. But this is like we'll get a very minimal amount of protein, not a large amount of protein, but still the proteins can be expressed in a in vitro system like this. Okay. Then we have yeast system, as some of you already pointed out. So in the yeast system, some of the common yeast strains which are used for expression of proteins are Pichia and Saccharomyces. Okay. So these are the two most common yeast systems which are used for expression. Then the ultimate system for eukaryotic expression is mammalian cells. Okay. So you know, most of the time we are trying to express mammalian or human genes in different systems. So if we are expressing them in mammalian cells, that will be the closest system to the human. Okay. So that is the most highly rated system. Only drawback with the mammalian cells is they are not able to produce large amount of protein as we see in E. coli. Okay. So we have different ways in which we can express proteins in mammalian cells, either through plasmid mediated plasmid as a expression vector. So it can be either transiently expressing the protein of our interest, or it can be stably expressing by stable transfection of the mammalian cell lines. Then also we can induce mammalian expression using virus infection. So different viral vectors are available, like adenovirus, retrovirus, lentivirus. Okay, so this slide shows you overview of different system, prokaryotic system, eukaryotic system, as well as in vitro expression systems. Okay, now one by one we'll cover the different eukaryotic system. Okay, so okay, this slide will tell you why we want to use. What are the advantages of mammalian expression systems compared to the other systems? So this slide, or you in general, eukaryotic expression system. Okay, so mostly the main problem in prokaryotic expression system like E. coli is we do not get all the post-translational modifications of the protein. Okay, so what do you mean by post-translational modification? Can you name some of the post-translational modification under which the proteins undergo? Anybody unmute your mic and tell one or two post translation modification you know.
Splicing.
Excuse me?
Splicing.
You know, post translational is once you have your protein, or translation means converting your mRNA into protein, okay? Translation. So it is post translational, okay? So once you have your protein getting formed or already formed, then whatever modification happens to the protein as such, to amino acids, okay? Protein is nothing but a sequence of amino acids. So whatever modification happens on the amino acids is the post-translational. What you are telling is post-transcriptional, okay?
Message hai kuchh nahi. Some participants are retained in message box. Aur kal hi maine कुछ एग्जाम्पल्स बट
फोल्डिंग ऑफ प्रोटीन
फोल्डिंग इज अ नेचुरल टेंडेंसी इट इज नॉट अ मॉडिफिकेशन हैव यू गाइस हर्ड ऑफ फॉस्फोराइलेशन
करना बोलो अनम्यूट करके बोलो करना एंड अदर
हेलो सर
यस
यस
ग्लाइकोसिलेशन फॉस्फोराइलेशन एंड there are ubiquitination, there is also post transcriptional modification,
not
post translational, sorry, post translational modification.
Yes good. Okay, so this is what I am talking about. Once you have your protein getting translated, during the translation process or after it is completed, proteins get modified. Okay, so you know the proteins comprise of different kinds of amino acids, and there are some functional groups which are there which can be modified. They can have they are active sites, so they can be modified. Okay, so and these post translational modifications are very important for proper functioning of lot of proteins. Okay, So if those modifications are not present, those proteins might not be active. Okay. So phosphorylation, glycosylation, sumoylation. Okay, these are some modifications which are very common in eukaryotic proteins, and if they are not there, the proteins might not function. Okay, so that is an advantage of mammalian expression system, that since this is similar to what actually they are undergoing in the normal condition, so they will provide the all post-translational modifications which are normally absent when we use a prokaryotic system. Some modifications can happen, but most of them are absent, because you know these all modifications are enzyme-mediated reactions. It's not happening randomly. Okay, so for example, if you want to do phosphorylation of a protein, you need an enzyme which is called what? What kind of enzyme does phosphorylation? Anybody knows? What an enzyme that will do phosphorylation is called?
So kinases.
Right, correct. Okay, so you know kinases will carry out phosphorylation. Okay, so it's a enzyme mediated reaction, so it will not happen randomly. And if you don't have that particular enzyme present, your modification cannot be done. Okay, so that is the one major reason that prokaryotic system will not have all the enzymes which are required for these modifications, and thereby they cannot carry out these modifications. Is it clear to everybody? So that is one of the drawback of prokaryotic system, that they lack the enzymes and hence they cannot carry out these modifications, and that is the advantage of mammalian system. Okay, secondly, as I already mentioned, because the modification happens, the proteins become highly functional. In absence of modification, their activity or functionality is compromised, or it might be totally zero. Okay, so that requires that your modifications to be there, and mammalian system provides that functionality to the proteins. Then very high compatibility to human. You know, a lot of time we are trying to make this recombinant proteins for some diseases, okay, where you need to inject them into people who are suffering from diseases. Okay, so if we are making this protein in a prokaryotic system, sometimes it might not be very compatible to humans, because it has come from a foreign source, it's not a mammalian source. Okay, so there might be some problem with, if there are some bacterial contaminating proteins with that, or some so that can induce immune reaction. Okay, so that problem is solved if we are expressing our protein in mammalian system. So that protein will be very compatible to humans. For example, insulin we are injecting in humans. Okay, so a lot of time insulin, now they have very good technology that even insulin produced from E. coli, it's very robust, and if there is no impurities, then it is not creating any problem. But if there are any trace impurities of other E. coli proteins, it can create problem, and especially immune reactions can be caused. Okay, so if you are using mammalian system, that part is so already I said, so those proteins which are used produced using mammalian expression will very low immunogenicity, they will not produce any immune reactions. Okay, so that is another advantage of using mammalian system. Then if you are using non-human cell lines, then they will not be susceptible to human pathogens. Okay, so for example, right now we are seeing this particular example right now, like, you know, our SARS-CoV-2, our coronavirus. Okay, coronavirus is able to infect us. Okay, but it's not able to infect all the animals, not all the mammals are infected. Okay, so that means you, if you are producing your protein of interest in a cell line which is not a human cell line, and it is not able to get infected with human pathogens, then your protein of interest will not be a problematic thing. Okay, so that is another advantage, is you can use multiple types of mammalian cell lines, then again very safe to use. Okay, so you know, we mammalian cells, maybe are mammals. Okay, so if we are handling our own cells, there is safety wise there is no concern. Okay, our cells will not infect ourselves. Okay, so that is why they are very safe to use. So these are some of the advantages when we are using the mammalian systems. Okay, so what are different? I just mentioned verbally some of the modifications, and some of you already mentioned some modifications, you know, but this is just one slide, so I'll just cover this also. So you know, in eukaryotic system, we have protein synthesis which is occurring in the cytoplasm or on the ER, okay, rough endoplasmic reticulum, where we have the ribosomes. There we have the protein synthesis occurring, and these proteins, as soon as they are getting synthesized, they are processed and they are post-translationally modified, and that will not only give them activity but also stability. Okay, and these are enzyme catalyzed reaction, as I just mentioned previously. And one of the example is disulfide isomerase, which makes that proteins that are produced regain the correct configuration and they are folded correctly. So all the disulfide bonding which is required for secondary structure are in place, then only it can fold, proteins can fold properly. Also proper glycosylation, adding of sugar moieties to the required site. You know, there can be O glycosylation or N glycosylation based on which residues and where which amino acids are targeted. Then you can have this glycosylation, which is again required for protein conformation, localization, and stability. Okay, so these are all different common modifications which are required for an active protein, proper folding, and proper localization of the protein within the cell. Okay. So first system which we are going to cover is the yeast system, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which is also called as baker's yeast, and you must have all heard about this. And this is the image on the top right shows how they look. Okay, so these are how the Saccharomyces cerevisiae looks under the microscope. And what are the different advantages of this system? So this is the most common and well characterized eukaryotic system. Okay, so this has been used in production of lot of recombinant therapeutic proteins, which I will show in the next slide. So this has been used in lot of biotech industry, and lot of companies are using this system to produce recombinant proteins. So how, what are the properties of Saccharomyces cerevisiae? It's a single cell. You can see here it's a budding yeast. So from single cell it can bud into, but normally it is a single cell. And it behaves like a bacterial culture. Okay, so it can be grown like a bacteria, and then it can also be grown cheaply. So the media which is used to grow this are also simple media, and it can be easily scaled up. Okay, you can use a small scale culture to test the expression, and once you standardize your expression system, then you can make it into a large scale system. Okay, so big fermenters can be used in industrial scale. So you can, that's scaling up is easy. Okay, so that's an advantage of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, and also it's well characterized for many strong regulatable promoters. You know, promoters, different promoters you must have heard in the prokaryotic system, different promoters which are used, strong promoters, weak promoters, or regulatable promoters. Can anybody tell one strong regulatable promoter of E. coli or a prokaryotic system which you must have heard or learned?
Anybody? लिख दिया, देखिए.
Okay.
Okay.
And for regulation, can you name for regulation any molecule, any chemical which is used to regulate?
IPTG.
Induction, protein induction. IU.
बोलो सही बोले बोलो.
IPTG. IPTG.
Yes, yes. IPTG. Okay. Anybody knows the full form of IPTG?
वो तो मैंने भी नहीं बताया. But at least नाम याद रखे उससे it's good.
Isopropyl beta thiogalactosidase. Okay. So this is molecule which can be used for regulating prokaryotic expression system. But similarly, in the eukaryotic system, in Saccharomyces cerevisiae, there are several strong regulatable promoters known in the naturally occurring plasmid, and that can be utilized to regulate the protein expression with different inducers. Okay, again, another important aspect of Saccharomyces is that it can carry out most of the post translational modifications which are happening in the mammalian cells. Okay, so that way the proteins which are expressed here will be mostly functional proteins, even human recombinant proteins. That's why are being produced in this system, because they carry out most of the post translational modifications like humans. Another thing is, secretes very few of its own protein, you know. So what is the advantage is that if its own proteins are not secreted outside the system, one easy way to make our protein of interest to purify it easily is that to add a secretory signal to our protein of interest. If you put that secretory signal, then it might come out, and that way, because there will be very less host contaminating proteins, it will be easy for us to purify our protein of interest from the supernatant. Okay, so that is another advantage of using Saccharomyces cerevisiae. And another important aspect is that it is safe to use. You know, in India, normally what we say that if something is approved by FDA, US FDA or USDA, we think, yeah, that is the ultimate approval and it will be safe. Okay, so this system is USDA and US FDA approved. Okay, so that means it can be used safely. So any questions on Saccharomyces system till now?
Sir?
Yeah.
Yeah, sir, here it, one point that is secretes very few of its own protein. So it is naturally occurring or genetically engineered?
No, no, its own. So its own protein, so that is an advantage in the sense, if we have our protein of interest, if you want to see, if you our protein of interest remains within the yeast cell, and we want to purify from there, we have to lyse this yeast, okay, Saccharomyces, and then our protein will be mixing with its own so many thousands and thousands of protein, okay. So that will be more difficult to purify. So since its own proteins are not secreted, if we make our protein of interest getting secreted, okay, then we have to purify from a very few contaminating proteins. That will make our effort very less.
Yes, sir. Okay.
You got the point?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, then what about the proteasome machinery? Can't we it degrade our desired protein?
See. Proteasomal machinery, it's not like all the time it is active and degrading. Okay, so we have to it degrades mainly if there are misfolded proteins and when proteins have passed their half life. Okay, so we have to have proteasomal machinery not degrade on its own. We have to have particular signal for it.
Karuna, कहाँ बैठी हो तुम?
यहीं पे हूँ सर.
बहुत बैकग्राउंड साउंड आ रहा है, एयर का साउंड.
No.
Sir,
okay,
is it clear?
Sir.
Okay, you have to have ubiquitination of protein for its degradation. Okay, it will not degrade on its own.
Oh, okay, sir. Okay, got it.
Okay, so this slide, gives you list of some of the recombinant human proteins which are being produced using Saccharomyces cerevisiae. That includes vaccines for hepatitis B, malaria, HIV, some diagnostics like hepatitis C virus protein, HIV antigens, human therapeutic agents like EGF, insulin like growth factor. So this is a big list of some of the therapeutic proteins which are produced using the Saccharomyces cerevisiae.
I think इसका question ये हो सकता है, because in E. coli we use that protease deficient E. coli strain for expression, like BL21. Generally we use that lone protease and OMT protease deficient E. coli strain.
Yeah, that is true. But in eukaryotic system, you normally what you have is you all the proteases generally they are not openly available in the cytoplasm. They are sequestered in certain organelles. Okay, so that's why when you do protein purification, that time everything mix up, so you have to add a protease inhibitor. Okay, but if you are not lysing the cell, if the your protein of interest is just coming out of the cell secreted, then it will not degrade.
Are you getting, Karuna?
सर आप अपना मतलब आंसर एक बार रिपीट कर सकते हैं सर.
सी इन केस ऑफ यूकैरियोटिक सिस्टम द डिफरेंट प्रोटीएजेस आर नॉट लाइक दे आर नॉट फ्रीली अवेलेबल इन साइटोप्लाज्म. दे आर प्रेजेंट इन ऑर्गेनल्स. ओके
लाइसोसोम
व्हिच आर नॉट व्हिच इज नॉट द केस इन बैक्टीरिया. ओके सो प्रोटीएजेस आर इन लाइसोसोम एंड अदर ऑर्गेनल्स. So only they come in contact with your protein if you lyse the cell. If you lyse the cell, then you have to add protease inhibitors to prevent your protein from degradation. But if you are not lysing the cell, if you are allowing your protein to be secreted, they are not coming in contact with any of the proteases and they will not be degraded.
Okay, sir. And sir, another question was that in bacterial system we use tag amino acid for identification and purification purpose, like histidine and that. So in eukaryotic system, we also had some that tag protein.
Tag we can add any his tag, we can add flag tag, there are several tags, we can HA tag, GST, all can be added.
They are mainly amino acid or protein?
They are amino acids only.
Okay sir. And sir, what about the nucleases and nucleases that is present in host cell system?
No. Nucleases will not affect protein. Nucleases
doesn't affect. No, but it can cut our gene, na?
No, foreign gene. With nucleases, you don't think everything is freely floating. There, our protein is not getting affected by nucleases because it's not freely available. Otherwise, our entire genome will be also chopped up. Okay,
sir.
Then what are the disadvantages of Saccharomyces? So this slide will list. So it's not like everything can be done just using Saccharomyces. So it is able to produce lot of proteins, but still it has some drawbacks. What are those? So level of protein production is low. It's not as high as which we get in E. coli. Okay. So there is also tendency of hyperglycosylation. Okay, resulting in change of protein function. You know. Anything in excess also is bad. If there is absent also will lead to inactive protein, but if you put excess of that also can lead to change of protein function. Okay, so hyperglycosylation is more glycosylation than required. It is also glycosylation at the amino acid where it is not required also can result, that will lead to change in protein function. Also some of the proteins are retained in periplasm, increasing the time and cost for purification. You know, even if you put the secretory signal, they might still not come out and they will be retained in periplasm. Okay, if they are in the periplasm, then eventually you have to lyse the cell and that will increase the time and cost of purification because you have contaminating proteins then. Okay, so to overcome some of the drawbacks of Saccharomyces cerevisiae system, another yeast system which was developed was the Pichia system. Okay, so Pichia pastoris is another system, yeast system, which was developed and it is also quite popular. And as you can see in the picture, this Pichia also looks similar to our Saccharomyces. They are also like budding yeast and single cell organisms. So what are the advantages of using Pichia system? What are the characteristics of this system? Okay, so these are methylotropic yeast, means they are able to utilize methanol as the source of carbon and energy. Okay, so they can grow on methanol. Second thing is they have more controlled glycosylation. So this glycosylation which happens in Pichia system is more like what identical to what happens in the human cells. Okay, alpha 1 2 type. Okay, so that the proteins which are glycosylated, they are correctly glycosylated and they will retain the activity. Third is it doesn't produce ethanol. So what happens with our Saccharomyces system is the end product is ethanol. Okay, so ethanol when it is produced, it gradually builds up in the system, and once it reaches a particular threshold like say 20% or 25%, it will inhibit the growth of Saccharomyces. Okay, so if it inhibits the growth, then there will be no more protein production possible. The yeast is not growing, it will not produce protein. Okay, so pitcher has that advantage that it will not produce ethanol, so that growth constraint is not there. And also, normally similar to our Saccharomyces, it also secretes very few proteins, and thus simplifying the purification of secreted recombinant proteins if we put a tag for it to get secreted in the media. Okay, so this is advantages of pitcher system. So we can overcome some of the disadvantages of Saccharomyces system by using pitcher. And again, this is also not a perfect system. So if we still face problem, we have more systems which can be utilized for our expression of eukaryotic genes. So the next gene, which also next system, which I am also going to discuss in detail, is the insect cell baculovirus system. Okay, so let's see what it is. Okay. So baculovirus insect cell system. So here you can see that we are trying to use two different things. So one is virus and insect cell. Okay. So it's a combination of these two things. So you can see on the top right, so this is our insect from which our cell lines, these are the cells, okay, so which are getting from this insect. So this is a insect called fall armyworm. Okay, so this is the most one of the common insect from which the cell lines, insect cell lines are generated and which are used for this particular baculovirus system. So what are baculoviruses? So baculoviruses, the name suggests they are viruses. So they are a large, diverse group of viruses that specifically infect arthropod, okay, insects, and not infectious to other animals. Okay, so their host are arthropod, okay, insects. So they will be infecting only insects. So it will not be infective to human cells. Okay, what are the common cell lines which are derived from our armyworm? This one armyworm. So this is all the your botany or geological name is Storoptera fugiparda. Okay, so this is two cell lines. So SF means from here S and F. Okay, so SF9 and SF21. These are the two most common cell lines which are derived from this worm. This is how the cells look. Okay, these are SF9 cells. Okay, under microscope they will look like this. So these are the two common cell lines which are derived from this, which are model systems for expression of eukaryotic system. And they are very suitable for expression of recombinant proteins, and they utilize baculovirus expression system, which we'll be discussing in next few slides. Another advantage of these cells are they can be grown both as adherent and as well as in suspension. So you can see that our E. coli system or yeast system, all they were being grown in suspension. Okay, but these cells, they have property that they can stick to the your plate, so they can be adherent, and they can also be grown in suspension culture. Okay, so this is the advantage of these cells. So how you produce your protein of interest in this? So your desired gene of interest, whatever your human gene or mammalian gene for which you want to express your protein of interest, is incorporated into a baculoviral genome. So what you do is you put your gene of interest in the genome of baculovirus, and this baculovirus is now then introduced into this insect cells. These cells are host to baculovirus, so this insect cells will produce baculovirus, and when they produce baculovirus, since your gene of interest is also incorporated in the genome of baculovirus, your recombinant protein also get produced as baculovirus propagates in insect cells. Okay, so when baculovirus is making its own proteins, it will also make your protein because you have introduced your gene of interest into baculoviral genome. Okay, so this is how this system works. And there are several baculoviruses, but most common specific baculovirus which are being used extensively comes from Autographa californica. This is the name of baculovirus. And this falls under a common name, which is a multinuclear polyhedrosis virus. Okay, so this is one of the common baculovirus which is used for this expression system. Okay, so as I said, there are different kinds of baculoviruses which can be used, but we cannot discuss each and every baculoviral genome. So today we will discuss one of the most commonly used baculovirus insect cell system, which is commercially available from one company called Thermo Scientific. So I don't know how many of you have heard of this company, but this is one of the biggest biotech companies which provide solutions for all kind of most kind of biotech or biological research, and they also provide entire baculoviral insect cell system, reagents for baculovirus insect cell system, and this come under a name called back-to-back baculovirus insect cell system. Okay, so this is their name to this system. So this system comprise of what all things? So one thing is they have this insect cell specific vector. The name is PFASTBAC for baculovirus. Then they have modified E. coli DH10BAC competent cells. Okay, so this is what modifications they have done in this E. coli strain. We will discuss in next slides. Then there is a transfection reagent called Self-Acting 2. This transfection reagent allows transfection of insect cells with our BACmates. Okay, I will come into that BACmates in the next few slides. And another important thing which is required, because this is insect cell baculovirus system, the insect cells themselves. Okay, so you can order insect cells which are SF9 or SF21 also from this company. Okay, so these are the requirements when we want to use baculovirus insect cell system back to back. Okay, so what are the steps if you want to use this system? So as was done for the prokaryotic system, first you have to clone your gene of interest into this baculovirus shuttle vector, which is called PFASTBAC. Okay, so it's called donor plasmid, in which you have to clone your gene of interest. That is the first step. Then you have to transform this recombinant vector, which you have your gene of interest cloned into this DH10BAC E. coli competent cells to generate a recombinant BACmid. So what is recombinant BACmid? So BACmid is nothing but a baculoviral genome. Okay, so what happens that these cells, what DH10BAC, you can see BAC. So what this BAC stands for? That these cells harbor entire baculoviral genome in them. Okay, so that's why these are modified E. coli cells, that they are carrying the entire baculoviral genome inside them. Okay, so when you transfect this shuttle vector containing your gene of interest, what happens that your gene of interest get transferred from this vector onto the baculoviral genome, which is present in the E. coli cells, DH10BAC E. coli cells, and it makes a recombinant BACmid. So how this all happens, I will be explaining in detail in coming slides. Okay, so once you have this recombinant BACmid, that is nothing but a recombinant baculoviral genome containing your gene of interest, you isolate that recombinant BACmid, and that you have to transfect into insect cell line, which can be SF9 or SF21, by using your self-actin. Okay, the self-actin which I showed in previous slide, that is used to transfect this insect cell with your recombinant BACmid. And when you transfect, you know this insect cells are host for this baculoviruses, so they will start making, they have the genome inside now, so they will start making baculoviral proteins. When they are made, baculovirus proteins will come together and assemble in form of a functional baculovirus. Okay, but along with that, it will also express our gene of interest, because we have incorporated our gene of interest into baculoviral genome. And to express our protein of interest in a larger amount, what we have to do is we want to amplify this baculovirus. So once we transfect our recombinant BACmid into SF9 cells, insect cells, it will make some recombinant baculovirus, but they will be less in number. So you want them to propagate, make more of them. So what you do is that this recombinant baculovirus, which will be produced in the initial transfected cells, they will be also secreted in the media. So you collect the media can use that media to infect more and more cells, okay? So that when they infect more cells, they will make more copies of themselves, and thereby it will cause amplification and increasing the titer of the baculovirus. And once you increase the titer, it will take 3 to 4 steps, then you will have a very high titer baculovirus, recombinant baculovirus, that you can use to infect more cells to produce your recombinant protein of interest. Okay, so these are the steps which I'll now show in the coming slides in form of diagrams, so it will make the things clear to you that how all these steps are carried. Okay, so this is the diagram, vector map of the PFAST back vector, which is commonly used. Okay, so you can see, as in the beginning of today's lecture, Dr. Gopalji was discussing with you the MCS. Okay, so you can see this is the MCS for this multiple cloning site for this one, and you know all the other features which are listed here, that it has antibiotic resistance genes. So you have gentamicin resistance gene here, you have ampicillin resistance gene here. Okay, then also what you see here is you have origin of replications here. So you have PUC origin of replication for allowing this multiplication or replication of this plasmid in E. coli. F1 origin, to if sometimes it's required to produce single stranded DNA, then RNA, then it can be used. Okay, and also you have polyadenylation site here, PA of SV40 virus, and also you have a promoter here. So this PPH is polyhidrosis virus promoter. So this is the strong promoter before your MCS, before your MCS. So MCS, all the genes cloned here will be under this PPH promoter. Another important aspect of this vector which you can see here is what is written here, TN7R, EN7L. Okay, so you must have heard of this one concept of jumping genes. Okay, so you know these are called transposons, which are they have ability to migrate from one place to another. They can incorporate in any genome, and these are a common feature of some of the viruses. Okay, so these viruses, when they infect a different host, they have some genes which can get incorporated in the host genome, and because of the enzyme called transposase, okay, because of that this can happen. So taking advantage of this property, this particular system, the baculovirus insect cell system, use the same transposase and transposition to incorporate our gene of interest into baculoviral genome. Okay, so for that, this insertion sites are created. This is flanking sites. Okay, this is not entire site, but this is the right side of the transposition site. This is the left side of transposition site, and in between we have our gene of interest will be put here. Okay, so these two sites, then as in we can see in the next coming slide, so anything in between these two, TN7R and TN7L, this entire region will get transposed into baculoviral genome, which will have acceptor site for these two. Okay, so this will make more sense when we see the actual slide for that. Okay, so next slide, this particular phenomena will be clear to you. Okay, so also for this, we need, as I mentioned here, that for transposition, this is again an enzyme dependent mechanism. So we need a enzyme called transposase. So this transposase should also be present, otherwise this cannot happen. So this transposase is also made to be present in the our E. coli BH10 back strain. So it has this transposase present in form of a back. So what are the features of E. coli BH10 back cells? That first thing I mentioned, that it contains the entire baculoviral genome, which is called BACMID. And the name given to that is PBMON14272, and it is 136 kb kilobases long. Okay, so that is first thing which is present in this particular E. coli strain. Second, what are the features? So it is a low copy number with mini F replicon, so it doesn't make lot of copies of it. It's a low copy number BACMID. It has a kanamycin resistance marker, so that to maintain itself in the DH10 back cells, we have to provide kanamycin in the growth media so that it can be maintained in that. And also another important aspect of this BACMID is a segment of DNA encoding the LAGZ or LAGZ alpha peptide from a PUC based cloning vector is introduced in the genome of this BACMID, and using where a site for bacterial transposon TN7. Okay, so TN7 transposon site is created. TN7, it's a mini site, so mini attachment. ATT is for attachment, so mini attachment site for TN7 is also introduced in this BACMID. And what happens that this mini ATT TN7 site is not having, so you have this LAGZ gene is present within the mini ATT TN7 site. The insertion of this particular LAGZ does not interrupt the or disrupt the reading frame of LAGZ peptide. Okay, so what happens that this LAGZ, you know what LAGZ encodes for? Do you know from your previous lectures, LAGZ alpha, what it encodes?
Yes, I have already described about blue-white screening and LAGZ.
Okay. Then yeah. So if you know blue-white screening, then it is fine. So LAGZ alpha will produce beta-galactosidase, and IPTG and XGAL, it will produce blue colonies. Okay. So in this case also, this DH10 back cells, normally if you do screening, they will produce blue colonies because their LAGZ alpha will be producing beta galactosidase. Okay, so that is the one of the feature of these cells. Okay, this BACMID, apart from BACMID, they also carry a helper plasmid. Okay, so what are the feature of helper plasmid? So when BACMID propagates in this DH10 back cells, it has kanamycin resistance, and if you have, you can complement LAGZ deletion present in the chromosome by presence of LAGZ in the genome itself, and it will be giving blue-white blue colonies in presence of XGAL or BlueGAL and IPTG, which I just mentioned. So this is the one of the feature. And as I just said, for transposition function, it requires transposase enzyme. So for that transposase enzyme, there is a mini helper plasmid is also present within these cells, and this helper plasmid is named as PMON7124. It is 13.2 kilobases, and it encodes transposase enzyme, and also it confers resistance to tetracycline. Okay, so and this helper plasmid, which will help in providing the T7 transposition function in trans. Okay, so these are the all features of your E. coli DH10 back cells. I will just summarize again. So it contains the baculovirus genome. The baculovirus genome also contains LAGZ alpha within the mini attachment site for TN7 transposase and for transposition. And transposase enzyme, which is required for transposition, is encoded by another helper plasmid, which is present within the E. coli cells on a plasmid vector, helper plasmid PMON7124. And in trans, the transposition function will be carried out. Okay, so now what is the strategy? So whatever I am speaking now, you can see in form of diagrams. Okay, so what all steps are required? So here, as I mentioned previously, this is our PFAS vector in which your gene of interest you have cloned. Here you can see here, your in red is your gene of interest, and as I said, it is between that TN7 right and TN7 left transposition sites. Okay, and when you transform this recombinant donor plasmid into your competent DH10 back E. coli cells, what happens is that your gene of interest, which is again shown here, and this is your BACMID, this is your helper plasmid coding for transposase. And as I said, within this BACMID genome, the LAGZ alpha gene is inserted, and within the LAGZI alpha gene, this mini attachment site for TN7 transpose is present. Okay, so this is what will happen, that when you put this recombinant donor plasmid in the E. coli cells, the transpose is getting produced by helper plasmid, and that will lead to transposition of your gene of interest from your helper plasmid, donor plasmid, onto the BACMID genome here. But when this transposition is happening, this will also disrupt your LAGZI gene present on the BACMID. Okay, so in the next slide you can see, so this transposition event happens, and now your gene of interest is transferred from your BPFAS BAC vector onto the baculovirus genome. Okay, so your gene is now inserted here, and what will also, it will disrupt the LAGZI. So now if you want to do blue white screening, your LAGZI is not there, it will not produce beta galactosidase, and thereby you will not be able to get blue colonies. Instead you will get white colonies. So if you, whatever white colonies you are getting, they are the ones in which this transposition has happened. Okay, so you have to screen for white colonies, and you have to now use these white colonies for your recombinant BACMID isolation. So you select the white colonies, grow them, and you know, as I mentioned previously, to grow them you have to put 3 antibiotics to make sure that it grows, these cells grow perfectly well. You have to put 3 antibiotics. Can somebody name the 3 antibiotics which are required, will be required to grow them? Based on the previous slides, can you name the 3 antibiotics which will be required to grow this?
Gentamicin.
Yes.
Ampicillin.
Yes.
Another, I don't know, sir.
For helper plasmid, there was another, tetracycline. Okay.
Tetracycline, yes.
So when you want to grow these cells, you have to add these 3 antibiotics to make sure that everything remains in the cell. Nothing is thrown out by the cell. Okay. So once you have this white colonies, you screen the white colony, grow them, and then you can, like you do plasmid preparation, you can do BACMID isolation from them, and whatever BACMID you get will be a recombinant BACMID containing your gene of interest from here. Now it is come here. Okay, so you can check the presence of your BACMID by doing a PCR, which is gene, using gene specific primers. Okay, so you can confirm the presence of your gene by using PCR, and then do a electrophoresis where you can check the product size, required product size, and if it is coming, that means your gene of interest is now present in the recombinant BACMID. Is it clear to everybody till now,
sir?
Is it clear to everybody,
sir? I have a question. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Sir, why we cannot transfect this donor plasmid to directly to our insect cell? Is there any need why we are become BACMID plasmid?
Okay, good question. What I mentioned to you is that this, in this particular system, we are using baculoviruses. Okay,
so, yes,
so baculoviruses, how they will get generated? Because for generating baculoviruses, you need baculovirus entire genome.
Yes.
Okay. So with this PFAS bac doesn't have baculoviral genome. Baculoviral genome is in BACMID. You got the point. This is just a transfer or shuttle vector which is used to transfer our gene of interest into BACMID. Okay. BACMID has the entire baculoviral genome. So if we transfer BACMID, then only baculoviruses will be formed. Making sense?
Okay, sir. तो अगर हम हमारे होस्ट सेल जो होंगे इंसेक्ट सेल, तो उसमें जब ट्रांसफेक्ट करवाएंगे तो वो नेचुरली जो वायरस जैसे ट्रांसफेक्ट करता है, ऐसे ट्रांसफेक्शन होगा, क्योंकि ये तो मतलब
गुड पॉइंट. फर्स्ट टाइम, यू नो, फर्स्ट टाइम वी आर ट्रांसफेक्टिंग इज नॉट वायरस, वी आर ट्रांसफेक्टिंग द जीनोम ऑफ वायरस. ओके, दिस इज द जीनोम ऑफ वायरस. ओके, so that time we have to transfect using a lipophilic agent like self-actin or transfectin. Okay, so that is a transfection. But once this genome goes inside insect cell, this genome has all the information for all the proteins to be produced to make a functional virus. Okay.
Okay. So
once it goes inside insect cell, it will make all the proteins of baculoviruses, and also it will make our protein because that is also part of the genome. Okay.
Yes.
Now, other proteins will help it to make a functional baculovirus. So it will make virus. Those viruses will divide in the insect cells, and they will keep dividing, and one time will come that they are so many copies that they will burst open the insect cells, and they will come out in the growth medium. Okay. So, but our protein of interest will not become part of the virus because it is not naturally to be part. But what only will happen that our protein will be also produced and it will remain in the insect cells. Okay.
Okay, sir. Yes? Got it.
Okay. So these are some examples from my own lab how the blue-white screening is done. So you can see here these are three different genes which I was doing, and you can see again. These are plates, as we are mentioning, all the for selection, we have to add different antibiotics. You can see this is a Luria agar plate containing kanamycin, tetracycline, gentamicin, X-Gal, NIPTG. You can see all this label. So you put all these things in the media, make the plate with all these components, and then you, after transformation, you plate the cells. And so these are the colonies of E. coli. The blue colonies are showing where there is no transposition happening. So your X-Gal will give blue color because of the beta-Gal active in those cells. Okay. While you can see here the white colonies are the one where your beta, your LAG-Z gene is disrupted by your gene of interest, and it will not produce beta-galactosidase. So they will not produce blue color, and you can see them as white colonies. Visible to everybody, white colonies?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so these white colonies are the recombinant dacmid-containing colonies. So these you can isolate, grow them, and then you can isolate the recombinant dacmids from them. Okay, so these
So why there is so less white colony?
Why? So this because the efficiency of transposition is not great. Okay, you don't expect 100% efficiency.
Okay, so it's transposition बहुत कम हुआ इसलिए ऐसा दिख रहा है sir.
Yeah. So this is comparatively good transposition. Okay, so normally you will not see a lot of transposition.
Okay.
So once you isolate the dacmid, you can run the gel. So you can see this is an example. Your dacmid DNA, you can check on the by agarose gel electrophoresis that to confirm that your dacmid is isolated. And then you can, as I said, you can also confirm by PCR, which I have not shown here, but you can confirm by PCR for the presence of your gene of interest. Okay, so you can have gene-specific primers, and you can use that gene-specific primers if you get the product of your required size. That will confirm that your gene of interest is present in your recombinant dacmid, and that then you can use these dacmids for transfection into insect cells. Okay, so as I said, SF9 cells are one of the common models for transfection. This is how it looks in the adherent form when you see under microscope. So these are mostly round cells, and they adhere very well. And what are the other properties of insect cells? As I said, these cells are generated from the pupal ovarian tissue of the fall armyworm, which is Strodoptera frugiparata. Okay, and these are stable cells, and these are the characteristics. They grow well in monolayer as well as suspension. They are also adherent to serum free media. Normally, to grow them, we add serum in them. The normally fetal bovine serum is used, but they now several companies also offer medium which are serum free medium, which we don't add serum, but they have all the nutrients required for their growth. So serum free medium can also be used. They are suitable for transfection, generating high titer virus stocks, and expression of recombinant proteins cells are regular in size and easy to manipulate. They can be easily transfected, easily grown, allow post-translational modification. So insect cells, they have most of the enzymes which are required for mammalian modifications. So that's why this is an ideal system, that most of the modification, all most of the kinases are present, so all the phosphorylation events can happen. Okay, so that is why this is one of the system of choice. And the doubling time is 72 hours. Okay, so they double in number every 72 hours. Okay, so how?
No, sir. Yes. Sir, in this SF9 cells, there is a written that there is a serum-free medium. So, कैसे हम न्यूट्रिशन उसको प्रोवाइड करते हैं? सीरम के फॉर्म में प्रोवाइड नहीं करते तो उसको हम कैसे?
That is what. So you know, can anybody tell or you tell that what nutrition serum provides? What all things serum has?
Serum has some proteins. मतलब growth hormones.
Yeah.
Growth hormones. Oh.
Serum there mainly, you know, growth factors, okay? Growth factors and hormones are present in serum. Okay, so in serum-free media, this is commercial companies sell them. So they don't actually reveal the entire composition, but they provide all the growth required growth hormones or growth factors within the media. So we don't have to add serum. Okay.
Okay,
so what will be the strategy once we have to transfect the cells? Okay, so you have this recombinant BACmate, we have isolated, confirmed by PCR containing our gene of interest. So now you can use this to transfect our insect cells, okay, using our transfection reagents like self-acting 2. And as I said, once we transfect inside the cells, this BACmate has all the proteins, all the genes for the proteins required for making a functional baculovirus. Okay, so this virus will contain not only its own genome, but our gene also we have incorporated in that. Okay, so that gene also will become part of the baculoviruses. Okay, so you can see here this insect cells now being grown in the adherent mode. We transfect them, and once we transfect them, this genome inside will give rise to baculoviruses. And these baculoviruses, when they will divide, make more copies, they will eventually rupture the cells and come out in the medium. Okay, so these are the baculoviruses which are coming out in the medium. And you can see a small dot in red, which depicts our gene of interest. Okay, so these are viruses, baculoviruses, but they also contain our gene of interest within itself. Okay, so once you have these viruses, you know, you collect these viruses from the media. And these viruses, now somebody asked in the beginning that now these viruses need not be transfected. Okay, they can directly infect now, because these insect cells can be infected by viruses. So you don't have to carry transfection step again and again. First step is transfection. Once you get the virus, collect the media, and this media you can now incubate with more cells. Okay, so this will have comparatively less viruses, because these are coming from number of BACmates which went into the cell. Okay, so you have to first amplify them also, make more virus, high titer virus. Okay, so that's why this first generation virus are also called P1 virus. Okay, so this you have to isolate, and this you have to infect more viruses. Okay, more cells. Okay, so infect more cells with P1 viruses. When you infect more cells, they will produce more virus that will become the your P2 viral stock with more virus. So higher titer, and this you use to infect more and more cells, and that will give to rise to more high titer virus, which is called P3 stock. Okay, so P3 stock is the one which you use for your recombinant protein production now. Okay, so you have to, after this transfection, you have to do two steps more for amplification of the virus. So amplification means you use very less virus. So per cell you get one or two virus infecting each cell. Once it gets into the cell, one or two virus will make more copies. It will make 50-100 copies before it will burst open the cell. Okay, so what you got from one or two virus, you got 50-100 virus. That means you amplified the virus 50-100 fold. Okay, so that will make high titer virus. Same way you do another round, you will add very less amount of virus into the cell, and then they will go inside the cell, make more copies and burst open the cell, and in that case also make even higher titer virus. Okay, so this is called increasing the viral titer. Okay, so you now at the end of these three steps, your P3 viral stock is called very high titer baculovirus. Okay, and how will you make sure that your cells are getting infected? So you see, this is example. If when you have successfully infected the cells after transfection, you see this is a control cell where you don't do the transfection, and this is example where you did the transfection with your recombinant Bacmid. So in the cells where you do transfection, their growth rate becomes slow, because now in these cells your virus is getting produced, so the cell machinery is getting utilized to make virus. So these cells stop dividing, or they divide very slowly, while the control cells, they divide fast. And you can see in 3 days these cells have filled the complete plate. Okay, while in this case, after 72 hours of infection, the cells have not grown much. That is a good sign that your cells are infected, and now they are busy in making virus, and that's why they are not dividing. Okay, so this is how after 72 hours your control cells and in transfected cells will look. More examples, you can see the transfected cells will be less in numbers, and that is a sign that they are getting virus made in them. Okay, so once you make your high titer virus, then you make a sufficient amount of high titer virus, say for example 50 ml to 100 ml, or sometime if you make if you need more protein of interest, you have to make even 1 liter of that. Okay, so you make sufficient amount of high titer P3 virus based on your requirement, and then once you have high titer virus, now you are ready to make your protein of interest in high amount. And now at this point you can switch from adherent mode of your insect cell into suspension mode, because now you want a large amount of cells. Okay, so you want to infect large amount of cells. So on plates, if you do, you need lot of plates. So it is easy that you grow the cells like your E. coli in a suspension culture. So now you can grow culture in large 1 liter, 2 liter or 5 liter flask. You can grow in bigger flask. And normally what we do is, suppose you want to infect 1 liter of insect cell. So normally what is done, if you want to infect 1 liter of culture, then you grow them in minimum 2 liter flask, or better you grow in 5 liter flask for better aeration of the media for the cells. Okay, and what normally is done, that once you have this 1 liter culture, you make sure that the cell density is at least 1 million cells per ml. Okay, so you count the cells, and you make sure that when the density is 1 million cells per ml of culture, that time for each 1 liter culture, you can add 100 ml of your high titer P3 virus. Okay, so normally this is how you can do. So you incubate your 1 liter culture at the density of 1 million cells per ml with 100 ml of high titer P3 virus. And this time, you know, you want to make your protein of interest. You don't want to kill the cells. So you don't incubate it for very long time, that cells will be ruptured. Okay, so you normally infect them only for around 48 hours. So once you incubate your high titer virus with your insect cells, 1 liter insect cells, you incubate. Another important aspect of insect cells, which I forgot to tell you, that these cells, they grow at 27 degrees. You know, normally mammalian cells, which we grow, they normally grow at 37 degree, because you know our body temperature is 37. So a lot of time mammalian cells, they grow at 37 degrees, and also they require 5% CO2. But insect cells, they don't require CO2. Only they have temperature requirement of 27 degrees. Okay, so you grow them at 27 degrees. Yes.
Sir, why it not requires 5% CO2 incubator?
No, you know, in our system, all cells, we we breathe in, breathe out, and we have to maintain a particular level of CO2 and oxygen in our blood. Okay, so in this case, to maintain that 5% CO2 is because, you know, there have to be equilibrium. Also, our buffer also requires the media. It need to be buffered. Okay, so that's why we maintain this 5% CO2 in our mammalian culture. But insect cells don't have that requirement. Okay, so they have only temperature requirement. So 27 degree we have to maintain. Okay.
Okay.
So once we are ready with this 1 liter and we infected with them for 48 hours, then our protein of interest we are ready to purify. So normally somebody asked in the beginning that can we have our gene of interest with a tag? So yes, you can have tag, you can have his tag, you can have flag tag, you can have GST tag. Okay, so that if you have a tag, that will help you in purification. Okay, so here I'm giving example of one of the protein which I'm working on. It's called Huntington protein, and this protein we have put a flag tag in the gene, so we can use flag affinity purification. And this is example of how after purification the protein looks like. So this is all purified in my lab using the insect cell system, and you can see these proteins are pure proteins. There are no other contaminating proteins. You can see this is in this gel, no other protein. You can see this only one protein, the protein of our interest, which was used using which was expressed using baculovirus insect cell system. And this protein also has a flag tag for affinity purification. So you can see this is highly pure protein, and you can confirm this protein by doing a Western blot. In this case here, you can see the same protein be confirmed by Western blot using specific antibodies against this protein, and you can see this band is highlighted here. So this is confirmation by Western blot. Okay, so this system allows for very good purification. Very pure protein can be obtained if you have a affinity tag like flag tag or his tag or GST tag, which can be utilized. Okay. Okay. This is the end of our insect cell baculovirus system. If you have any question, you can ask now before we move to the other mammalian expression system.
Sir,
anybody has any doubt, any question, ask now.
Yes, sir. Sir, is there any nematode derived cell line can we use?
Excuse me.
Nematode-derived cell lines.
Nematode. Oh, yeah. Nematode-derived cell lines can be used. But again, the thing is, no such cell line has been, the expression levels is very important. Okay. You can use for small transient expression studies. But the problem is for large scale purification, those cell lines have not been established.
Okay, sir.
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, in prokaryotic system, there is no contact inhibition phenomena, but in eukaryotic, so how many hours should we grow? But means this phenomena doesn't affect the insect cell growth.
What phenomena you are talking about?
Contact inhibition, sir.
No. There is, in the case of insect cells, when we grow in suspension culture, okay, I already mentioned that the optimal number should be 1 million cells per ml. Okay, so at that, if you grow at that concentration, there is no problem.
Okay, sir. Sir, and another question is that, In E. coli cell, there is a baculovirus genome, but can't we have a natural virus which has a baculovirus of its own genome, and we used to transfect directly into our insect cell? Means here we are producing the virus and then again transfect it. But can't we do the natural transfection like virus does?
Okay, good question. But How will you, if I give you, okay, I give you a baculovirus, okay?
Yeah.
I give you baculovirus, you incubate with insect cell, it will infect, okay? For sure. Mm. But in that baculovirus, how will you introduce your gene of interest? Okay. So you have to introduce your gene of interest. You have to produce your protein also. You just don't want to produce just baculoviruses.
Yes.
Okay. So to introduce your gene of interest, these particular steps are required.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Okay, but yes, sir. But in bacterial system, there is a vector like a phagemid, cosmid, where then in that we insert our interest of genome. So how that is possible? If it is in this case, this is not possible. So how this is possible in that case?
No. Here we are introducing. Here also we are introducing our gene of interest in baculoviral genome through transposition. We are introducing our gene of interest in baculoviral genome.
Can't get it, sir.
No, you are saying that we are not able to introduce, but we are introducing our gene of interest into baculoviral genome or not in PFASTBac.
Yes.
That gene, red color transposition we cloned, that gene we cloned in PFASTBac vector, we transformed into VH10 back cells, and that gene, because of the transposition event, it got incorporated into baculoviral genome to give us the recombinant BACMID, which we use to transfer insect cell to generate recombinant baculoviruses.
But it is possible that we isolate viral genome and then we cut through restriction enzyme and then put and then we insert our foreign gene?
Baculoviral genome is the viral genome only. In the DH10 back cell, whatever is there is a
baculoviral genome. Yes. Yes. Yes, sir. But you say now that there is a if you give me that viral strain, so it will transfect our insect cell naturally. But how we will insert our foreign gene? So does we do like that? That we isolate the viral genome and then cut with the restriction enzyme and insert our foreign gene?
Yeah, that can, I mean, technically that can be done. Okay, it's not, it cannot be done. It can be done. You can have, if you have viral genome, if you have the right restriction sites, then you can insert. You can insert. It's not like illogical. It can be done. But you know, it's such a large genome that it is difficult to not have the right restriction site. As in the beginning, Dr. Gopalji was telling that you should have a zero cutter. Genome 136 kilodalton kilobases, so that might be difficult to get a restriction enzymes of interest which can be used to clone the gene.
Okay.
समझ में आया करना?
हाँ सर, आ गया.
मैं चूंकि मोबाइल से यूज कर रहा था, मेरी यहाँ लाइट नहीं था, इसलिए मैं नहीं वो कर पाया. But that is the reason we cannot in vitro like T10 ligate. Are you getting? There is problem of digestion and ligation. We cannot get that unique site where we can clone our gene of interest in their genome.
Yes.
वहाँ पर मैं उसका जो transposition किया जाता है और in vivo में bacterial cell के अंदर ही उसको transpose किया जाता है अपने design को. Cannot manipulate outside the cell. Because it's very big. So whatever restriction site you will choose, that might have present anywhere in the genome.
Okay.
Gopal sir,
okay, got it, sir.
Can I interrupt?
Kya, sir?
Is it clear? Can I move forward?
Anil ji, kuch bol rahe hain. Anil sir, bataiye.
I think what she wanted to ask is.
Yes.
Sir, शायद वो ये
आपका वॉइस नहीं आ रहा ठीक से.
कह रही थी फॉर एग्जाम्पल जैसे हमें लैम्डा वेंचर दे दिया. हेलो
हेलो
नाउ इज इट क्लियर सर?
हेलो
हाँ सर, वो शायद ये पूछना चाह रही है कि जैसे कॉस्मिट्स होते हैं ना. हेलो तो जैसे कॉस्मिट्स में क्या होता है, हमने कॉस्टाइट्स डाल दिए हैं और उसके बाद वी कैन इंसर्ट लार्ज सेगमेंट्स ऑफ डीएनए एंड देन वी कैन डू इन विट्रो पैकेजिंग. तो वैसा वो सोच रही है कि कुछ ऐसा क्यों नहीं कर सकते.
यस यस यस
सर, इन विट्रो पैकेजिंग कर लेते हैं और उसके बाद इन्फेक्ट करवा देते हैं उससे.
Exactly. So that it can produce our protein of interest. That's why this specific transposition system is used.
Okay, sir.
So there are two things. One is ligation of our desired DNA into the genome of the virus. And second thing is packaging in case of cosmid or phosmid. Oh, that part.
Mm-hmm.
So what is your exact packaging ka bol rahe the ya usko ligate karne ka? Because we use this transposition for introducing our gene, desired gene, into host genome, means that virus genome.
मैं पैकेजिंग का भी बोल रही थी सर कि मतलब जैसे हम ये कॉस्मिड में जैसा करते हैं कि अब जीन ऑफ इंटरेस्ट डाल देते हैं, फिर वो आर्टिफिशियल फिर वो अपने आप वायरल कोट में पार्टिकल हो जाता है. अदर एक अलग से रखते हैं जो वायरल कोट प्रोटीन बनाए और फिर वो ट्रांसफेक्ट करे, तो ऐसा कुछ उसमें पॉसिबल हो सकता है इंसेक्ट सेल इसमें कि जैसे.
In vitro packaging is possible in case of baculovirus or not?
Yes.
That can be done. Okay, that can be. That is a totally different topic. That you can. Yeah, you want to.
I think since this bacteriophage genome is very small in comparison to baculovirus, I think. What is the size of baculovirus genome?
136 kilobases.
136. So. In vitro packaging, I think there is no such coat type of protein. So I don't think it is easy to package that long genome. In case of cosmid and bacteriophage, it's 48 kb and complete coat protein and tail proteins are known. So in vitro packaging is possible, I think. What is kya bol rahe aap?
Jo P1 phage hota hai sir, usme bhi genome 100 kb se zyada ho jata hai. वो भी पैकेज तो हो ही जाता है. तो इसमें भी आई थिंक पॉसिबल होगा, बट पता नहीं विजय रवि सर ही बता पाएंगे शायद क्या प्रॉब्लम होती
है. सी यू देयर टू डिफरेंट थिंग्स. ओके सी नॉर्मली यू कैन डू पैकेजिंग. वन थिंग इज टू मेक अ लाइब्रेरी और फॉर अदर पैकेजिंग पर्पस आल्सो यू कैन यूज, बट हियर वी आर नॉट गोइंग इनटू दैट एरिया. ओके we want here fully functional baculovirus, so entire genome should be there. We don't want any, you know, in packaging sometimes we can provide one gene deficient, two gene deficient, we can play with all that, but here we want a fully functional genome. So that's why this baculovirus, this transposition system has become an ideal system for this. Okay, so we want very site specific insertion of our gene of interest. Okay, so
that
provides the site specific insertion.
Okay, sir, got it. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so we'll now move on to the next slide, which will be the mammalian expression system, which are the model mammalian expression system. Okay, so there are several cell lines, you must have heard also, several cell lines which are being used as a mammalian expression system, but we will discuss some of the most common and most popular cell lines which are currently in use. So one of the cell line is CHO, also called Chinese hamster ovary cells, and another is NSO or NS0 myeloma cells. Okay, so the CHO cells, normally they are used in adherent system, while NSO cells can be used both adherent as well as in suspension. Okay, so these are two common cell lines, but how do you establish and what are the features of them? Okay, so as I just mentioned, first most common is the CHO, which is an epithelial cell line derived from ovaries of Chinese hamsters. Okay, so this is one of the most common use. Then we have BG44. It's a modified CHO cell line. So you know, these modified cell lines are used to allow for selection. Okay, so you have a particular gene deletion in them, or you can have an additional gene added into them, so that particular gene marker, for example, you in what we just checked for eukaryotic system in prokaryotic system as well as eukaryotic system in insect cell, that we put certain selection markers like antibiotic marker, okay, amphicillin resistance gene, or okay. So similarly, in mammalian cells, instead of antibiotic resistance marker, you can put a marker gene, so you can select by presence of a particular media. In this case, for example, this case selection can be done in thymidine-less media. So these cells can grow in thymidine-less media. Then we have modified CHO cell line DUKB11. So this can this has a marker of glutathione synthesis. Okay, so this is another modified cell line, NS0 or NSO cell line, which I mentioned. It's a modified B lymphocyte cell line. It can be grown in suspension also. HEK293, it's an epithelial derived cell line from human embryonic kidney cells, and it is made by transforming with adenovirus DNA. HeLa, which is one of the very common cell line, most of you must have heard of this. So HeLa is a human cervical cancer cell line, which is also used in a lot of labs for eukaryotic system or mammalian cell line. COS, or COS cell line, which is a fibroblast cell line, which is derived from kidney cells of African green monkeys by SV40 virus transformation. And so this is a list of some of the most common mammalian cell lines which are used for protein expression. Okay, so when we use these cell lines for expression of mammalian proteins or recombinant proteins, we have to use, or we have to introduce our gene of interest into them. Okay, so what are the common ways in which we can introduce our gene of interest into mammalian cells? So one of the most common ways, using the plasmids. Okay, so DNA plasmid, DNA vectors, expression vectors are the most common way to introduce our gene of interest into the different cell lines which I just mentioned in the previous slide. Okay, so what are the features of plasmids? Okay, so main features of eukaryotic expression vectors: they should have a promoter region, they should have a multiple cloning site where we can clone our gene of interest, they should have a DNA segment for termination signal, also should have a polyadenylation signal in there, should have a selection marker which will allow for selecting our, whether we, our cells are transfected cells, we can be able to select using that selection marker. There should be an origin of replication in E. coli so that we can propagate our plasmid in E. coli, and also it should be able to replicate in eukaryotic cells, so it should be having eukaryotic origin of replication also. Also, we can have ampicillin resistance marker for propagation in E. coli. So these are the, some of the common requirement for a eukaryotic plasmid vector where we want to express our protein of interest in eukaryotic cell lines. So this is a typical a commonly used eukaryotic expression vector, which is called CMV, containing the CMV promoter, cytomegalovirus promoter. Okay, so you can see the features of this promoter, this expression plasmid. So the promoter here is cytomegalovirus, which is a common eukaryotic virus. So promoter is a strong promoter. Then we have MCS downstream of this promoter, where we can clone our gene of interest. Then we have human growth hormone polyadenylation site here, downstream of this. And we have SV40 origin of replication for eukaryotic expression. We have PBR322 origin of replication for E. coli expression, E. coli propagation, ampicillin resistant marker gene for ampicillin for when propagating our plasmid in E. coli. F1 origin of replication in if you want to make single strand RNA from this. Okay, so these are the features of eukaryotic plasmid, and this is mainly used for expression of our gene transiently, where we don't want our this plasmid vector to incorporate into our human or the mammalian genome. Okay, we just want transient expression. We transfect, we wait for 24 hours or 48 hours, do our experiment with transiently expressed our gene of interest, and then we are done with it. Okay, so this is a common example where we use for transient expression, but sometimes we want to use it for stable expression. We want our protein to be purified, then we have to use a slightly different system. So this is an example of a slightly modified system of plasmid. A common example is PCDNA3. So this has all these features of a CMV containing expression system. You can see here, this also has a CMV promoter. We have a multiple cloning site, then we have a polyadenylation site, F1 origin, SV40 origin. We have ampicillin resistance marker. Okay, but apart from all this, what you can see is an additional feature here is a neomycin resistance gene. Okay, so neomycin is giving resistance to G418 or genetisin. Okay, so this is a eukaryote selection marker. So if you provide this particular selection marker in the cells which are transfected with PCDNA3, the genome will be, this vector will be maintained in the cell, and eventually by chance effect, this genome, this vector will be incorporated into the host genome. Okay, so that once it incorporates into host genome, that cell line becomes a stable cell line. Okay, so then you can maintain the selection pressure by putting G418 or genetisin in the media, and that cell line you will be able to use for expression of protein for longer time, and also for purification of protein. Okay, so these are the two plasmid, common plasmid vectors for transient transfection and for stable transfection. And again, these are some features which are listed, which should be present in the your model plasmid vector. You should have a 5' untranslated region before your gene. We should have a COSAC sequence. This is COSAC sequence in vertebrates. It should be present in the gene. If you want your protein to be secreted, then there should be a signal peptide or signal sequence should be present. Then if you want to put a tag for affinity purification of your protein, you can put a sequence tag here. So it will allow for affinity purification. Then you can have a proteolytic cleavage site, which is P. So if you want your protein of interest should not contain the tag, so after purification of your protein, you want to remove the tag sequence, you can cleave the protein using the specific cleavage site for the protease which you have introduced here. That will cleave the tag, then your protein of interest will not have the tag. And also you should have stop codon at the end and 3' untranslated region. Okay, so these are all required components of gene of interest. You can choose to have tag or not, it's up to you. Also this signal sequence for secretion also, it's up to you. Okay, so but these are all possibilities which can be done. Okay, so in eukaryotic promoters, we have different list of promoters. I gave you example of CMV promoter, but different promoters can be used. Now this is, I'm not going to detail of each promoter, but this is listed that what are the features of them. So CMV promoter is a strong mammalian expression promoter. Constitutive means it will be expressing at all times, it's not regulatable, and it is strong, so it will give good amount of protein expression. And we have EF1 alpha, so it's a endogenous, so it's a strong mammalian expression from human elongation factor 1 alpha. Okay, so it's not coming from any virus, it's an endogenous promoter and a strong promoter. SV40 is again from virus, okay, but it's also a strong promoter. Then you have UBC promoter, or PGK1 is also a human mammalian promoter for phosphoglutaric kinase. It's also a constitutive. And some of the examples I want to give is for inducible. Yeah, this is one. So this is TRE, is a tetracycline regulating element containing response element containing promoter. So this is a regulatable promoter which is inducible by tetracycline or its derivative like doxycycline. Okay, so this is where you want your gene to be expressed only under certain condition. Then you can use this promoter. When you want to be induced, you add tetracycline or doxycycline, then your gene will be induced. Otherwise, in absence of that, it will be not induced. Okay, so these are regulatable promoters. Then you have Drosophila specific promoters, US promoters are there. Then you have other actin promoters from Drosophila. These are all, this is constitutive, while US is specific. It requires the presence of GAL4 gene to activate the promoter. So this is specific in sense that it requires presence of another gene for its own expression. This is another list of several other promoters which are used. So you polyadrin, we just said that insect cell have polyadrin promoter. Then we have this CAM K2. This is a calcium calmodulin dependent protein kinase promoter specific to expression in certain cells where this particular gene is expressed. Okay, so this is a big list, and based on what your requirement, you can select this different system, different promoter systems, whether you want constitutive expression, cell specific expression, or your inducible system. Okay, so this all systems, several promoter systems are available. These are different selection markers available. I just said that in case of our G418, I just mentioned G418 or genetricin, where your neomycin gene is present, then you can have this particular selection marker. But other markers can be used is blastocidin, hygromycin, puromycin, geosin. Okay, so these are the corresponding genes which are conferring this resistance. These are the cell types in which this particular resistance markers can be used. These are the mode of actions of this particular antibiotics, and these are the concentrations in which these antibiotics needs to be used. Okay, so again I mentioned before, we can either use transient expression where the plasmid remains in the cell for 24 to 48 hours. In this case, within 24 to 48 hours, we want to use whatever downstream effects of our gene expression we can do. Okay. It doesn't require selection pressure or application of plasmid. So whatever number of copy of the plasmid we transfer, whatever goes in the cells, they will be able to produce sufficient protein for our assay, and they will be not staying there for a long time. 24 to 48 hours, they will be there, and we have to do our assays within that time frame. So these are normally used for optimization of promoter and other elements. So before we want to generate our stable cell lines, we want to see that the promoter is producing some sufficient protein or not, and other elements if you want to put in there. So this will help you in that. Okay, so transient transfection, within 24 to 48 hours, you will know how much protein your protein is produced. So that will help in, if you want to make stable cell lines, you have to make sure that you use the correct promoter and other elements. These cells, this transient transfection or transient expression is used to make small scale protein for purification. It can be used in the promoter assays, interaction studies where you want to see protein-protein interactions. And if you want to make more proteins, or you know, or you want to make a stable expression of your protein, then you have to go for stable expression. So in that case, your plasmid vector is required to be integrated into host genome, and for that you have to maintain a selection pressure with antibiotics based on your selection gene like G418 or genetricin, which is most common selection marker. It requires an origin of replication for mammalian cells so that it can divide in the mammalian cells. And also this is using the mammalian system. Almost 140 recombinant proteins are currently approved for therapeutic use, and most common cell line used for deriving this recombinant protein is CHO cell lines, Chinese hamster ovary cell lines, which I mentioned initially. These are most common cells used for recombinant protein production. And there are two general methods in which you can introduce your foreign DNA into mammalian cells. One is direct transfer, in which you can have your plasmid vector directly transfected into your cell of choice by employing different methods like chemical liposome, calcium phosphate, the dextran method, polybreen, physical electroporation, or microinjection. In this different ways, you can introduce, directly transfer your plasmid vector into your cells of interest, and then it will make the protein. Or other ways, you have to use viruses, different viruses, which can infect your cells, and through virus-mediated transduction. So as we saw in case of insect cell baculovirus system, here we use different viruses which can infect human cells or mammalian cells. So we put our gene of interest in the genome of these viruses and allow these viruses to infect these cells, and thereby these infected cells will produce our protein of interest. So what are different viral vectors? So different viral vectors which are used are retroviral vectors, or retroviruses can be used, then lentiviruses can be used, adenoviruses can be used, okay, and adeno-associated virus. These are the different viruses which are normally used to infect our mammalian cells, and they have their own advantages and disadvantages. So for example, retrovirus have large packaging capacity, but can be only transduce dividing cells. They cannot be used for non-dividing cells. Lentivirus have they can integrate into genome, and they can cause possible transformation. So they can modify the cells. They can make the cells cancerous and modify other features. So that is the problem with lentivirus. Adenovirus are very efficient in transduction, but the size is less. They cannot do a large size, and also they can introduce immune response. Okay, so that is the problem of using adenoviruses. Then another system is adeno-associated viruses. So these viruses have advantages that they can provide long-lasting gene expression, means kind of stable expression, but their packaging capacity is limited to only around 4.5 kb of gene. Okay, so these are the some features, advantages and disadvantages of using viral vectors for introducing gene of interest into mammalian system, mammalian cells. Okay, again, this is a table again providing the features of them. Some additional features are here, like immune response. Some introduce low immune response, some will have high adenovirus can provide high immune response, dividing, non-dividing, target gene integration happens or not, what are the packaging capacities, and whether it will be stable or transient, or stable or transient infection or production. Okay, so these are the features. What are the disadvantages? So mammalian cells are not all the time advantages. They have also some disadvantages. So what are disadvantages? That mammalian cells are fragile, difficult to maintain, slow growing, and expensive. Okay, you know, the culture media for your E. coli or even for yeast are cheap, but for mammalian cells, the media is expensive. Most of the time, they require serum. There are no serum-free media. Okay, they require serum, that makes them expensive, and they are also require temperature, CO2. So they have more robust conditions required for their growth. So that's what I just said. Fastidious growth requirements are there. Insertion and selection of gene of interest takes time, because making stable cell lines, it takes sometimes 1 month. Okay, contamination with animal viruses. So these animal or mammalian cell lines, they are also prone to get infected with viruses. So that is, they can create contamination problems. So I think these are disadvantages of mammalian system. So they provide advantage that most of the time your protein of interest will be having all post-acellular modification. They will be folding properly. They will be active. But also another disadvantage which is not listed here is they will not be able to make that much amount of protein compared to our E. coli or yeast system. Okay, so amount of protein produced using mammalian cells is also a limitation which is not listed here, but they will not be able to get that much protein. So limitation is there, and they will provide mostly functional protein. Okay, So with that, I will end here, but I will take any questions which are with you. Okay, now I can take questions again. So now, based on mammalian system or entire presentation, you can ask questions. And now I will also come back to my usual mode so that I can see your faces and I can also see the chat box. Okay.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes. Yes. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. My question is regarding to cell culture.
Yes.
So here we are talking about the media using in cell line, cell culture. So in media, we have.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes. Yes. Go ahead. Go ahead.
When we order any media, sir, from high media or sigma, so there is option with absent L-glutamine absent or L-glutamine present media. So,
Hello? You are right. If you see any media company catalog, you will see they have multiple options. L-glutamine is one thing, but you see that. High glucose, low glucose, regular glucose, pyruvate plus, pyruvate minus, essential amino acid, okay, so sodium bicarbonate. There are several options, okay, not just you gave one example.